for this dieback is used. Again, here vancomycin is a cell wall inhibitor, gentamicin, aminoglycoside group. So these genes show much fluorescence, whereas the Tritonex, which is a well-known membrane disruptor, increase dieback fluorescence. So our natural peptide also showed a significant rise. That means these peptides has a depolarization effect on the cell membrane. And this is compound G10A. It shows that there is a so much increase in the membrane depolarization. Because after depolarization, there is repolarization. But when there is a so much depolarization, there is no chance to come back to repolarization, and it goes to forward to the cell membrane rupturing. So this is a flow cytometry. This is an untreated control. There is a less fluorescence for the propidium iodide and the dieback fluorescence. But this gramicidin is a standard drug, standard peptide. It shows that there is an increased fluorescence for both PI and the dieback fluorescence. And this is our vancomycin. It didn't show much fluorescence in PI. That means this vancomycin was not able to rupture the cell membrane, due to which there was no fluorescence. But peptides, G10A, show the both fluorescence. There also both fluorescence present. So it shows that there is a membrane depolarization and the cell membrane rupturing. Then we have to also check zeta potential, because it also tells the physiology of a cell membrane. So for this zeta potential, this untreated SORS showed minus 34 millivolt. But after treatment with SHA, it shows minus 22. So from minus 34, it decreased to minus 22. Then G10A, minus 22, minus 24. So they are significantly decreased as compared to untreated. But when we compare with the non-antibiotics like ofloxacin, doxycycline, vancomycin, there was a non-significant changes. So though these antibiotics inhibited bacteria, but there was no change in the zeta potential. So it also shows that it has a significant effect on the cell membrane. Then it's also estimation of reactive oxygen species, because this is also a secondary mechanism by which antibiotics kill bacteria. So these peptides at different concentration increase the reactive oxygen species, like if you compare untreated control, 142 fluorescence. But after treatment, they were all more than 300. But vancomycin, it didn't show much fluorescence as compared to peptides. And we know ciprofloxacin is also well-known compound which increases the reactive oxygen species. Then this is a calcium AM, because calcium AM initially, it is a non-fluorescence. When it goes inside the cell, due to esterase enzyme, it becomes fluorescence. And it will only come out when cell membrane is ruptured. So from this also, we can know that whether this peptide has membrane rupturing effect or not. So for this one, untreated control showed the maximum fluorescence, because all this dye was accumulated inside the cell. But after treatment, their fluorescence was decreasing. And the most significant was on G10A peptide. That means it ruptured so much that this dye leaked out of the cell, and there is a decrease in fluorescence. And potassium leakage assay is also important, because potassium is higher concentration inside the cytoplasm. But when the membrane is leakage, potassium will be leaked out. So for this, this inductively coupled plasma mass spectroscopy was used. So on untreated control, there was less amount of potassium leakage. But when we treat with peptides, there was increase in the potassium leakage. So it also tells the instability of a cell membrane. And it's also we also know that SRS is a biofilm-forming strain. So we use a strain ATCC6538. And this was an anti-biofilm effect at different concentration, like a 6 micromole and this 4 micromole. So this is an untreated control, so much biofilm. But after treatment, there was a less biofilm at different concentration, like 9 micromole and 4.5 micromole. So this is a, now another biofilm is a, it's really difficult to eradicate mature biofilm, because first one is the biofilm formation. But another second stage is the mature biofilm eradication. That is very difficult. Even non-antibiotics are not able to eradicate mature biofilm. But after treatment with our this peptide and in combination with vancomycin, there was a significant decrease in the mature biofilms. These are the eradicated biofilm wells. This is the mature biofilm, but after treatment, its intensity has decreased, and it is in combined with a vancomycin, G10A plus G7A plus vancomycin, so it shows a sinus effect. This is the AFM image of a mature biofilm. This is untreated control, and this is a treated one, it's decreased. And it also shows antifungal against Candida albicans and Candida glabrata at different concentrations like 12, 20, 20. And this is also flow cytometry for the fungus. It shows that there is a membrane ruptioning of fungus also. This is a AFM image of albicans untreated control, and this is a treated, we can see the difference. This is also treated group. And the main problem is the mix S. aureus and Candida species infection, because 20% cases were of S. aureus and C. albicans co-infection, and it has a very little synergism, because it, like treating S. aureus are difficult, but when there is a more co-infection of it Candida, it became more difficult. So this is a co-infection of S. aureus and Candida. So we have make a this co-infection, a Candida albicans and S. aureus. Even in the co-infection, these peptides were able to inhibit like at 30 micromole, 40 micromole. But vancomycin was not able to inhibit Candida. So this is a mixed S. aureus and Candida species planktonic cells at different concentration, like G10A at 5 micromole was giving a sinus effect with amphotericin at 1.5 micromole. But when we combine two peptides, 10A and 7A, amphotericin concentration decreased from 1.5 to 0.4. So it's a very significant synergism. So this is a mixed biofilm of S. aureus and C. albicans eradication assay. So vancomycin, amphotericin, miconazole, they were unable to eradicate. Even adding vancomycin plus amphotericin, it was unable. But when we add our peptides with vancomycin and miconazole or amphotericin, it shows a significant decrease in the mature biofilm. So we can say this is a Candida biofilm, but this is a mixed S. aureus and Candida albicans. We can see the difference that how co-infection make a strong mature biofilm. So this mature biofilm was eradicated after treatment with G10A, G7A, and vancomycin and amphotericin. And these concentration were in a less concentration, like below 2 micromole. So this is again mature biofilm, and this is with a synergistic effect, there was decrease in the mature biofilm. This is a S. aureus and glabrata biofilm. After treatment, there was a decrease in the mature biofilm. And it was also important to check the ecotoxicity of these peptides. So they were checked at 25, 50, and 100 mg per kg and given intraperitoneal. Out of these, G7A showed a good stability and less cytotoxic. So one peptide shows some cytotoxicity at higher concentration, like 100 mg per kg, but remaining two peptides, they showed a less toxicity. So conclusion, among new three single DNA substituted analogs, G4A, SHA, and G7A were found to be less hemolytic and less cytotoxic as compared to its parent peptide, and they showed the salt and serum resistivity, poses antimicrobial activity in high physiological salt and serum concentration. G10A showed potent anti-MRSA activity, but due to its hemolytic nature will be used for topical application, and this poses hemolytic effect and also poses anti-candida activity. This inhibit S. aureus biofilm formation and eradicate mature biofilm. And they also inhibit mixed culture of S. aureus, C. albicans, and Candida glabrata. And its combination with vancomycin, amphotericin, miconazole, they were able to eradicate mature mixed biofilm of S. aureus and Candida species. And this tested concentration of peptides in combination were below their cytotoxic and hemolytic concentration. So these are the future studies which will be done for these peptides, like artificial bilayer membrane will be used, molecular docking will be used. Then after intracellular SORS inside the fibroblast cells, in vivo models. So acknowledgement. In the name of Allah, the merciful, the beneficent, praise be to the Lord of all worlds, prayers and peace be upon our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and my supervisor Muhammad Dr. Iqbal Chaudhary, Dr. Shabana Usman Simji, Dr. Farzana Shahin and my friends. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rakesh. That was a very interesting presentation. A round of applause for Dr. Rakesh, please. Next, we have Dr. Peron Lucha with us today. Dr. Peron is a Master of Science with thesis in organic chemistry and a PhD in chemistry. He has a good grasp of organic synthesis, separation methods, advanced spectroscopic methods, natural products chemistry, medical and pharmaceutical chemistry, molecular stimulation, and modeling. He also had a 6 months postdoctoral scholarship for TWAS-ICCBS at HEJ Research Institute of Chemistry, University of Karachi, Pakistan. Dr. Peron, I request you to please make your way to the podium and deliver your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you and good afternoon to everyone. I'm Dr. Piron Lucha from Cameroon. I'm sure if there's anyone here with have an interest on football, he knows about Cameroon because it is one of the country where football is a main sport. But my presence here is not to talk about sport, it's to talk about science. And I'm doing green chemistry, and among all my research projects, I select this one to show how we can directly apply science in our everyday life. How can we use natural resources to take care of our body? So my presentation is entitled Antibacterial and Cytotoxic Secondary Metabolite from Sterospermum acuminatissimum. This is a plant which is well popular in tropical area. I don't know if it's also present here in Karachi, but we will discuss about it for some few minutes. My presentation will be in respect to this plant. So we will first of all have an introduction, material and method, result and discussion, and the outcome of the research. It is not something new to say that plant is important in our everyday life. We use plants every day as food, shelter, and also as a source of drugs. These are some examples of picture which can show how plants can be used in our everyday life. And this plant in this picture here is known as Catharanthus rosus, which was used in Madagascar it was used traditionally to treat some cancer. And nowadays, it is used as a raw material of the production of verblastine, this one, and verdesine, which are used as lead compound in the treatment of cancer, skin cancer. And by talking about cancer, each year more than 2 million of new cases of cancer are discovered. And because of cancer, about 1 million of persons pass away. As you can see, the number of people dying because of cancer is still high. This can be due to the lack of information by the population. It can also be, according to Zasegna and Kwam, the misuse or the abuse of drugs which develop or which favor the resistance, which favor the resistance drugs towards the currently marketed drugs. And the other point is the financial issue. Most of time in developing countries, people face financial issue. And as according to Fokonan, the modern drugs known as conventional drugs is 88.9 times expensive as compared to phytodrugs or drug coming directly from plants. And you can see here in this picture, in 2010, the generic drugs known as most available drugs, the price increased almost double, because we are going here at 45% to 103. So we need to look for new kind of drugs. Nowadays, many developing countries, mostly developing countries, are putting together traditional knowledge and modern medicine. Among these countries, China and India are the topest country practicing, putting together both knowledge. In Africa, in particular case of Africa, only 29% of population accept to put together traditional knowledge, which is here as phytodrugs, with modern drugs. In my country, the new politic is to build trust, respect, cordiality, and cooperation between traditional healers and modern physicians. From that, we come out with our hypothesis, which was to question if the stem bark of Pseudopelmo acuminatissimum used in the traditional treatment of malaria, diarrhea, skin rash is really efficient. From here, our objective was to evaluate, to first of all, do the chemical study and evaluate the cytotoxic and antibacterial activity of secondary metabolite from Pseudopelmo acuminatissimum. And to achieve this, we collected the plant material and we succeeded to isolate some compound by the means of chromatographic techniques. After that, we characterized the isolated compound using NMR, modern NMR method. And finally, we evaluate the cytotoxic and the antibacterial activity of the isolate. Pseudopelmo acuminatissimum is a big tree, mostly reported in tropical area, which can be, we can have up to 33 meters high. Locally, the pot is swigged with salt to treat cough, urea, skin eruption. Why? The stem bark, the infusion or the decoction of the stem bark is used to treat pneumonia, rheumatism, etc. And the decoction of the root bark is very efficient in the treatment of child diarrhea. Previous report on that plant let us know that it has antifungal activity, antiproliferative activity, and the main classes of compound was flavonoid, terpenoid, and trichinones, and for hirudoid to be the chemomarker of the plant. For the experimental part, these are some apparatus we used. This one is for biological experience. The stem bark of the plants were harvested in 2015 and dried at room temperature. The powder was extracted with methanol for 72 hours and then suggested to liquid partition, and we obtained the hexane fraction, the ethyl acetate fraction, and the water residue. Among the three fractions, only the ethyl acetate fractions was suggested to for further chemical study. From heat, we isolated and characterized a total of 8 compounds, where this compound was found to be a new compound. And for cytotoxic activity, we evaluated the activity of the new compound and one of the non-compound. These compounds were the mostly abundant or the most most compound in terms of quantity. From here, we use doxorubicin as the reference drugs, and we evaluate the in vitro assays of the compound on human leukemia monocyte THP1 and human lungs endocarcinom A549. The dose response curves, as presented in this image, shows that compound one here is the new compound, and compound two is this 3-oxohupan. Shows that compound two, which is the non-compound, was most active against both cancer cell line as compared to compound one. And since we were evaluating the cytotoxic activity in collaboration with the pharmaceutical industry, and the results were not so good, that's why we stopped the project. And based on the fact that population assumed that the plant is very effective to treat lung infections, we decided to continue with the research. And the crude extract of the plant, the methanol crude extract, was suggested for antibacterial activity, and we found that the activity was very significant in Staphylococcus pneumonia and Klebsiella pneumonia with MIC of 62.5. Why? The ethyl acetate fractions that we suggested for chemical study was weakly or moderately active. From here, we have an idea. Maybe the fractionation reduced the activity, but we are not sure. That's why we decided to continue and evaluate the antibacterial activity of the isolated compound. And the result on the same bacterial strain shows that they were very weakly active. So it has now become a proof that the fractionation reduced the activity of the compound. This can be due to the synergic effect, is to say the compound, the extract is active because of the combination of all the secondary metabolites present in the crude extract. So the aim of this research was to prove the activity of the plant. And the result led to assume the significant efficiency of the stem back of Cytospermum acclimatissimum against cancer and bacterial infections. This result is in accordance with the new way of finding natural treatment, because by the past, pharmaceutical industries were just looking for a single compound which must be active against a particular drug. And due to new pandemic, this is if a fraction or an extract can be active with less toxicity, it can be used directly because people have been using it for long. It's my pleasure to thank the University of Maroua, the DAAD program, the Yaoundé Bielefeld Graduate School, the ICCBS, and the SAP Institute of Science and Technology, and all the organizer of this international conference. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Perron. What an interesting approach to combine traditional methods with modern science. Attendees, next in line, we have Mr. Abdoulaye Segda from Burkina Faso. Mr. Segda is currently a thesis student on phytochemistry and anti-diabetic activity of Philanthus amaris Shium and Thorn. He has done his bachelor degree in biochemistry focused on natural substances and master's degree in biochemistry focused on natural substances. Attendees, please welcome Mr. Abdoulaye Segda as he makes his way to deliver his presentation.
So thank you. Thank you for introducing me. Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank the director of ICCBS who gave me a chance to be in ICCBS and then to participate at this scientific event. I am thankful. I would like to thank too the president of this institution who gave me the opportunity to present my research work in this scientific event. I am thankful. So my presentation is on a topic of ethnobotany and anti-ethnobotany of medicinal plants for diabetes and antioxidant activity of Philanthus amaris, Chrysanthellum americanum, and Striga hermonthica. This presentation will be articulated as follows. We will have a brief introduction, and then we will present the material and method uses. We will discuss the result that we get, and then finally we will conclude. As an introduction, ethnobotany is a multidisciplinary activity. Include basic documentation for traditional knowledge, quantitative assessment for natural resource use and management, experimental evaluation of benefits from medicinal plants, and finally, implementation of new projects to increase the value of local people obtained. Oxidative stress is a loss between oxidizing and antioxidant within a cell. It is associated with a beta cell dysfunction in diabetes. Many natural compounds isolated from plants has been identified as antioxidant. Philanthus amaris, Chrysanthellum americanum, and Striga hermonthica have been reported in folk use and biological activities. Let's look at the material and method used. This study took place in Burkina Faso, my country, located in the west part of Africa, and particularly in Bobo-Dioulasso. An ethnobotanical survey was conducted among 56 traditional health practitioners. The questionnaire focused on information about respondents and about therapeutic habits. Plants collected were extracted by Soxhle. According to antioxidant activities, polyphenol content were estimated by spectrophotometric method. The antioxidant activity was performed by DPPH method, according to Meda et al. Pearson test was used for statistical analysis. Let's see the result and discussion. Table 1 shows the demographic profile. And then, if we look closely, the sex male of the respondents were dominant. Age ranges to 51 to 60 years were most reported. Married, most of the respondents were married and then illiterate. The figure two present the frequency of citation of medicinal plant. A total of 28 plant medicinal plants were recorded, belonging in 21 families. And then three of these those plants were most cited: Philanthus amarus, Striga hermantica, and Chrysanthellum americanum. Yassine et al. Support that biodiversity is a potential source of novel drugs. This figure shows the distribution of plants used. And then we can see that leaves and whole plants were the most cited. Leaves and whole plants were the most used. Some authors support that leaves ensure the sustainability of the plants. The table two present the total, the polyphenol content. And then Philanthus amarus, methanolic extract of Philanthus amarus present the best content of polyphenol. Table 3 indicates the antioxidant capacity by DPPH method. Both of extract methanolic extract of both plants, Philanthus amarus and Striga hermantica, presented best result compared to the quercetin as a reference. Previous studies support that those plants are antioxidant. What can we remember as a conclusion? In this study, antioxidant activities could justify partially traditional use of plant medicinal for diabetes management. However, deep scientific investigations are required to make the evidence of anti-diabetic activity. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
Thank you so much, Mr. Segda, for that interesting approach. I would now like to request Dr. Kashif Ali to make your way to the front of the stage to distribute the shields to all three of our guest speakers. Dr. Rukesh, please make your way to the front of the stage. Dr. Peron Lucha. Mr. Abdullahi Segda. Thank you so much to our guest speakers. Next, we have, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Akil Ahmed, Dean and Chairperson, Department of Biosciences, Salim Habib University. Professor Dr. Akil Ahmed has more than 40 years of teaching and research experience. He is a professor at the Department of Biosciences and Dean of Science at Salim Habib University. Previously, he was associated with the Department of Microbiology at University of Karachi. He is an HEC recognized research supervisor and has supervised many masters, MPhil, and PhD students. He has published more than 100 research articles in well-reputed national and international journals. And during his research career, he has also won several research grants. He has been visiting faculty at Federal Urdu University of Arts, Science and Technology, Karachi, Jinnah University for Women, Karachi, Sindh University, Jamshoro, the Akhan University School of Nursing, Karachi, Dadabhoy Institute of Higher Education. His research interests include production of monoclonal antibodies, immunological reagents, development of serodiagnostic tests, screening biological potentials of plant extracts, purified semi-synthetic and synthetic compounds, monitoring microbial pollution, endophytic fungi, biotransformation, and biosafety and biosecurity. Attendees, I would like you all to please give a huge round of applause to Dr. Akhil as he makes his way to this stage.
Assalamu alaikum, ladies and gentlemen. I have chosen this topic because we sometimes feel that inflammation is nothing. It will just appear and then disappear spontaneously without any problem or any trouble. So I just want to give an introduction what the inflammation basically is. We all know it is recognized by the four signs, pain, redness, swelling, and heat. And sometimes, if it persists, may result in organ failure, loss of functions. All these signs are not always present. Some people have one sign, some have two, sometimes some have all these signs and symptoms. Okay. We consider the inflammation is a process or the beneficial process of immune system which heals the damages and also remove the unwanted agents from the body. Inflammation persists for a very short period, maybe a few hours, few days, and then when the body heals, this sign and symptoms disappears. But if something is present constantly, irritating the body, then this inflammation continues, and we call it chronic inflammation. And when this chronic inflammation persists for a very long period, it is a very dangerous sign. It may lead to very severe conditions of the diseases. It may persist for a long period and can be recognized by these systemic inflammatory response syndromes. Fever, people have more than 80 degrees centigrade, 38 degrees centigrade, increased heart rate 90, leukopenia, increased respiratory rate more than 20, leukocytosis 12,000, more than 12,000, sepsis, altered mental status, hyperglycemia, organ failure, and sometime death. But people don't recognize the importance of this inflammation. It is also response, or it may lead to chronic diseases or inflammations, leads to severe conditions. For example, cancer, heart diseases, rheumatoid arthritis, type 2 diabetes, obesity, asthma, and different neurological disorders. Okay, so we have to be careful, or we have to monitor ourselves. Is there any problem, any sign of the inflammation in our body? The factor that increases the risk of chronic inflammations include the older age, of course you can't do anything because people grow and become old, so it is one of the risk factor. Obesity, diet is very important, because if you take unhealthful diet, it may lead to chronic inflammation. Smoking, low sex hormones, stress, sleep problems. So these are the problems which may induce or leads to chronic inflammation. Then long-term diseases that doctor associate inflammation with, inflammation with the diseases like asthma, chronic peptic ulcers, tuberculosis, rheumatoid arthritis, peritonitis, ulcerative colitis, Crohn's diseases, sinusitis, and active hepatitis. Okay, you can see there are different diseases where you can see the inflammation. Another problem is we don't know the food we take could also be a problematic. So maybe the one food is good for one person, but the same food may not be good for other individuals. And there are different bases for this. So one man's food is another man's poison. So there's a link between the diet and diseases. Food is generally considered or could be categorized in three classes or three groups. One is we call the highly beneficial food. This beneficial food serve as a food nutrients as well as it has a medicinal properties. The second type is the neutral, just have the nutritive values. But a lot of food we take has the harmful or toxic-like substances. We call it junk food. So most of us love to take junk food. And believe me, the junk food is very dangerous for the health. So junk food may contain some poisonous-like substances, which we don't recognize, and when we keep on taking such food, we develop severe problems. I will recommend you to read one book, please. I find this book is very interesting, and if you have some problem, you will identify the cause of problem, and that relates to your diet. Okay, so it's a very simple book, Eat Right, for your type means your blood type, and written by the Peter Adamo. And you can see there are types. I'm not going to discuss the book, just want to introduce the book. You must read if you have time. According to the book, they say that the blood group antigens, these antigens are also found in some food or some microorganisms, and which our body is constantly exposed to. When our body is exposed to, our body responds and produces antibodies. And when we take food, this antibody may react with the antigens. So the many food aggregate the cells of certain blood types, but not others, meaning that food may be harmful to the cell of one type, may be beneficial to the cell of other types. You will trust this when you read the book. Okay? So I recommend you to read the book. This discovery provided the scientific link between the blood type and diet. We know that our food has a lot of lactans, and the lactin has the glue or the adhesive properties. It is abundant and diverse protein found in food and have agglutinating properties that affect our blood. These are the powerful way of organisms in nature to attach themselves to other organisms. Lot of germs and even ourselves use this super glue to their benefits. We eat food containing lactans that are incompatible with us. The lactin, when it binds with the cells settle down in some organ or some places. When they settle down, the immune system tries to remove this, and as a result, the problem starts, inflammation starts. And if it continues, if you continuously the same food which contains such type of lactans, you will have the problem for a long period of time. The clumping can cause irritable bowel syndrome in the intestine or cirrhosis in the liver or block the flow of blood through the kidneys. So it may cause problem if you take such food constantly. Fortunately, the most of the lactans which we consume is being removed from our body, but very small protein or the lactans, say maybe 5%, are filtered in the bloodstream where they react with the blood cells, WBCs or RBCs. When they react with this, sometimes they target some receptors, and these receptors then activate the cell to proliferate, make copies. Sometimes its reaction is good, sometimes the reaction is not good. There's one component of our wheat that is called gluten. Gluten is also an example of lactans, which is found in the wheat and grains. Now this gluten binds the lining of a small intestine, causing the substantial inflammations and painful irritation in the blood type, especially the O group. So the O group usually develop problems when they eat wheat. And this book says the wheat is a poison for the O group individuals. There are other factors which are also responsible for causing chronic inflammations, and one of them is the obesity. In obesity, it is a metabolic disorder or syndrome which is characterized by secretion of inflammatory mediators or apokines. These are a few examples. And these cytokines causes the enlargement and obesity. The blood supply to adipocytes may be reduced and leading to hypoxia. Hypoxia is a condition which may lead to cancer. It is proposed to be inciting the etiology of necrosis and macrophage infiltration into the adipose tissue, which leads to overproduction of pro-inflammatory mediators. Pro-inflammatory mediators means they are constantly source of inflammations. When the inflammation continue, it may lead to disorder like cancer. Chronic inflammation also related with the alcoholic consumption. Alcohol-related medical conditions. We know that alcohol use may damage our liver. And when the liver is damaged, it induces different type of pro-inflammatory cytokines. And the pro-inflammatory cytokine again creates trouble, produces inflammation. So as a result, it produces different type of reactive oxygen species, stimulate inflammation transcription factors. Hypoxia resulting from the alcoholic metabolism is also known to induce inflammatory response. So alcohol is a problem. When you consume alcohol, it may damage some tissues, especially the liver. And when the liver is damaged, it induces pro-inflammatory cytokines, and that may produce inflammations. And if it continue, the people may develop cirrhosis or the liver disorders. Another thing is that LPS, lipopolysaccharides, which is a part of cell, and when you consume a lot of alcohol, it kills the bacteria, and sometimes the bacteria may leak out from the intestine and come to the circulation, and it induces different cells to produce pro-inflammatory cytokines. We know that the constant use or chronic use of alcohol impairs the balance between the microflora of the gut and the gut barrier functions. When the function is blocked, what happens? The bacteria can enter into our circulation and induces inflammatory response. And when the defense is impaired, the systemic inflammation is an issue. The human gut contains a lot of microorganisms. 10^14 in one. It is believed that we have the more microbes than our cells we have. Okay. So the number of microbes are more in our body than the number of cells we have. The gut flora are recognized as important pathogenic factors in chronic inflammation-related diseases. So the translocation of such agent or their product play a role and causes some chronic diseases, including chronic heart failure, chronic fatigue syndrome, HIV or AIDS-associated dementia, chronic hepatitis C, and chronic alcohol diseases. Okay, so this is a problem in individuals who are large consumers of some alcohol. Another problem is for smokers. When you take or use smoking or the cigarette, we consume a lot of metabolites, and these metabolites may induce some cancers. So we know that it is established that the smoking may cause cancer, chronic and vascular disease, and oral diseases. The several components of the smoke also contain some substances which also affect our immune system and make the difference. What difference it makes in induces chronic inflammation at mucosal surface and modify host response to exogenous antigens, making the body susceptible to attack by microorganisms. It also affects on immunity depends on the many variables, but depends upon the dose and the type of tobacco, the route and chronicity of exposure, and the presence of other factors at the time of immune cell stimulations. And if this smoking continue, the metabolites continually induces immune response, and that immune response may be detrimental to the body. Cigarette smoking also impairs the innate defense against pathogens and modulate antigen presentation, promote autoimmunity, impair immunity of oral cavity, and promotes gingival and periodontal disease and oral cancers. So smoking is another problem we face, and we see people having some type of cancer, especially the oral cancer and the lung cancer. Stress. We don't believe the stress do something, but it is the major cause of different diseases. Common risk factor in 75% to 90% diseases. It also associated with the cardiovascular diseases, hypertension, atherosclerosis, and metabolic diseases like diabetes and non-alcoholic fatty acid livers, psychotic and neurodegenerative diseases, depression, Alzheimer's diseases, Parkinson's diseases. Okay? So we have to avoid stress. You have to know how to avoid the stress condition. And of course, it may lead to cancer. Recently, we had, or still there are some cases of COVID-19. In the severe cases, the 70% of the cases basically who die have aggressive immune response. They do not die because of the virus, but they die because of the inflammatory response, or we call cytokine storm. The regulation of the immune system fails in COVID patient. And in this patient, there's a high expression of cytokines, which are basically pro-inflammatory cytokines. And these cytokines induces inflammation, and that results in the destruction of the organ, and the destruction may lead to failure, and then the patient may die. So the conclusion is, there are several evidence supporting that the inflammatory response is a common factor in cardiovascular, metabolic diseases, psychotic, neurodegenerative diseases or disorders, and cancers. This is an established fact. There's no argument for it. So what we have to do? So the best practice would be to monitor health status, because sometimes in chronic inflammation, you don't know, you don't recognize the chronic inflammation. So you have to monitor yourself by screening yourself. For example, just detect some markers like IL-6, CRP, or ESR, or maybe some specific marker which the doctor recommend to you. And taking appropriate medication if necessary, and consuming healthy diet. This is very important, because if you constantly take the junk food contains a lot of substances which can induce abnormal response, and abnormal response may result in the some diseases, maybe cancer. So what is mean by healthy diet? We should be rich in antioxidants, which containing fruits, nuts, vegetable, eggs, especially people. I saw many people, because the doctor prescribed that take such and such medicine and avoid use of eggs. Eggs is a very good rich source of antioxidant, rich source of anti-inflammatory substances. And a rich egg with yolk, without yolk is no egg. And of course, mild exercise. In today's life, I don't see any people or a lot of people do any type of exercises. They don't have time to do any exercises. So make habit to do some exercises. At least spare some time, or you can simply just walk for half an hour. Avoid unhealthy lifestyle. Avoid consuming junk food, that is the toxic food, like alcohol. Stop smoking and lazy lifestyle. This is the message for today's. The life is very important, and you have to keep yourself healthy first by monitoring and then following these practices. Thank you very much.
It's become a source of stress for human body. Would you comment on that?
First of all, always take less food. Apna pet ko bhar dena is not a good thing. Okay? So when you take the required amount of food, you feel relaxed. When you overeat, you feel stressed. So don't overeat. Okay? So hamare mazhab mein na kam khaye is the best thing. Because you see, the food contain three things: medicinal properties, the nutrients, and toxic substances. When you consume large amount of food, so believe you are also consuming a lot of toxic substances. So less toxic substances your body can manage. If you take more toxic substances, sometimes your body fails to manage this. Yes, sir.
With your kind permission, I would like to add a comment here.
Sure, please.
Assalamu alaikum, everybody, and good afternoon. My name is Munawar Hamid. I'm a student at Zybest, and as well as I'm teaching at Keat University. Thank you very much for the presentation. Basically, I would like to share an experience of mine. I'm 60 now, and every day I run non-stop 5 kilometers. I would like to say just one thing. It's all about mindset. It's all about mind game. If you control your mind, you can definitely go for exercise. Thank you very much.
Yeah. You see, people play games. Lekin log games khelte hai na. Usme kya thakavat nahi hoti. So you get mental relax, but your body pain. Okay? So hum jab main jo brain ko ek tarah ka relief denge na, to hamare zehen jo hai wo body khud bahut sehatmand ho jayegi. So try to relax your mind, and you can give as much pain you can give to your body. When you give a pain to your body, it becomes tuned to work for. अगर आप काम नहीं करेंगे तो आपका जिस्म काम करने का काबिल नहीं रहेगा. हमारे एक टीचर थे, उन्होंने नई गाड़ी खरीदी. उसकी नई गाड़ी आई थी, क्या कहते हैं, ये FX. गरीब लोग थे, टीचर तो गरीब होते, तो उन्होंने गाड़ियाँ खरीदी तो, और उसको वो मेंटेन करते रहे काफ़ी दिनों तक ना. ही नेवर यूज द स्पेयर व्हील. चार पाँच साल के बाद ही जस्ट यूज द स्पेयर व्हील एंड स्पेयर व्हील बर्स्ट. See, so when you use something, it will remain working condition. But when you don't use it, then sometime when you need it, it will not work. So jaise hum kehte hain stress ko avoid karne ke liye, exercise is the best to avoid stress. Ye mane ya na mane, jo aadhe ghanta ya ek ghante walk karega, usko stress tolerance zyada hoga. And of course, one more thing, if you have constant problems, you please discuss with the consultant or psychiatrist. Hamare ek aur problem hai, hum psychiatrist ko bura samajhte hain. Psychiatrist is a very good friend of you. Agar koi aisa problem hai jo persist kar raha hai, aap samajhte hain aap resolve nahi ho pa raha, please visit him. Saying this, what I said, that food may be not good for you. So if it is not good for you, if you consume less, your body will manage it. Okay? But if you take the large amount of food, it means you are consuming undesirable food in the large quantity. So your body may not manage this, and the large quantity may cause some problem with you. So that's why I'm saying this.
So in your one slide, you have present one book, Catherine something. So can you show that slide? That you have present the relation of diet with blood group. So in that there are different blood groups, and specific to that there are different diets. In blood group O, like you have present, there is a hunter, and hunter means more likely to eat meat.
Yes.
So that means blood group O, that they have a good system, like in blood type O, there is so many meats, and if you compare like vegetables and others, so blood group O, they can tolerate red meat something, because red meat is not good for the GID system.
Do I have a time? Okay. Let's see. This book, what this book says, the human evolve. Hazrat Adam aaye the, ek single person the, unka koi blood group hoga. How they used to live? Na darakht khane ka shauk hoga, kuch hoga. So people just start their life by hunting. So they are basically hunter. Theek hai? So the O group, this book, according to this book, says the old people. They retain this property of hunting or eating meat. Believe it or not, it's true. All those who have the blood group O, if they do not follow this diet pattern, they suffer from acidity. Just say, agar aapko sirf karna hai na, ek jaiye bahar aur ek lijiye aur bataiye iska group O hai, kitne logo ko acidity hai? 85% will accept that they have the acidity problem. Okay? Why? Because our lifestyle meat pe nahi hai, hamara wheat pe hai. And this book says wheat is a poison. So just imagine. So when this book says wheat is poison, you suffer from this poison. Okay? So you pay some cost. So this book says The O group is basically the hunters. They live on the meat, especially. And they say the red meat is the best for them. Okay? This is, and you have to believe them, and I believe it. Second says, when, of course, when you start hunting, the animal will disappear because everybody eats. Then what will happen? The people starts then growing some crops. They become agrarian. That's why the A group evolved. Okay? So the A group depends on the dal chawal pe guzara kar lena. So they are basically, if you just screen your people and say how many are anemic, most of them belongs to A group are anemic. Because they do not consume or they cannot eat meat as compared to O group. Agar O group ko bitha dein, ek hi age ka, ek hi group ke ho, to O group wale zyada meat khayenge. Sukoon rahega. A group wale khayenge, to unko problem hoga. Okay, then they started having animals, and with the animals they start using their milk. So the third group evolved, which is called the B group, became the balance group. Usko kehte hain, wo sab cheeze balance karke kha le, he will remain healthy. Then AB, on mixing say AB evolved. Okay? So you must read the book, you will enjoy reading book. At least you will know yourself ki aapke paas kya kya cheeze hain, kya cheez achhi lagti hai, aapko kyun achhi lagti hai, kya wo hereditary character ki wajah se achhi lagti hai, ya uska zayqa achha hai. Theek hai? So I just introduced a book because I like this book. Isliye maine kaha ki aap bhi padhein, thoda sa maza aayega.
Thank you for a very nice presentation. I am a faculty member from Public Health. I wanted to ask that in one slide you said stress is related with inflammation. Can you explain how it is related to inflammation, like inflammation of which organ?
Okay. Chronic inflammation is generalized type of inflammation. So when you think, when you are under stress, what happens to you? Depression. All these factors stimulate your body. When they stimulate, the pro-inflammatory cytokines are also stimulated. And this, if it is continue, aapne dekha hoga jo stress mein log hote hain, unki recovery thodi si slow hoti hai. Tum se dekh lijiye, check pe bimari mein honge na, wo kehte hain mar raha hu, to mar jayega. Lekin agar wo stress mein nahi hai na, to kitna bhi usko problem ho na, log usko kahenge nahi, koi fark nahi padta, wo bach jayega.
My name is Dr. Bilal. I'm director Oric over there, and I'm a cyclist too. It is just comment. I've never seen any medical doctor of fit. मैंने उनका पेट निकले हुए देखे. Why?
Again,
I've seen every doctor, every medical professional having a belly, having a high cholesterol. Why?
Exercise.
Why?
They
know everything and
they
don't.
So that's okay, they know, but they don't believe.
So there is a contradiction in your knowledge and in your practice. Why?
Because they don't believe it. They read it.
So it means, फिर मैं सही कर रहा हूँ ना? मैं भी फिर सही कर रहा हूँ, फिर अपनी ज़िंदगी सही गुज़ार रहा हूँ.
जैसे गुज़ार है गुज़ारी.
Because medical profession, medical profession, my concern is the medical profession, the medical official should be the ideal. He or she should be the ideal, but they are not. They are not.
Believe.
Why?
Believe.
99%
they don't believe in their study.
Just, okay. I respect 99% medical profession, male or female, they have unfit body. Number one, I'm a cyclist. When I go and visit to the doctor, I say I'm a cyclist. They say, oh, you are a cyclist in this age. मैं हैरान होता हूँ कि एक मेडिकल डॉक्टर मुझसे ये परेशान होकर मुझसे कह रहा है यार तुम साइक्लिस्ट हो इस एज में.
देखिए जब हम लोग यंग थे ना बच्चे थे.
यू आर स्टिल यंग.
अभी हम थोड़ा सा अपने आप को ऊपर ग्रुप में समझते हैं. हमारा शौक क्या था? हम किराए के साइकिल लेके घूमते रहते थे. और उस जमाने के लोग आप देखेंगे ना, आपको कोई थिक नहीं मिलेगा. जस्ट 80s के अंदर आप देखें कितने लोग ठीक होते थे। अब क्या है कि अगर मुझे कहीं जाना है ना, तो मैं अपनी गाड़ी दरवाजे के सामने खड़ी करूंगा, I avoid walking, ठीक है। मैं, मुझे पता है कि वॉकिंग से क्या फ़ायदा है, लेकिन मेरा बिलीव नहीं है। मैं मेडिसिन पर खर्च कर दूंगा कि कोलेस्ट्रॉल कम करने के लिए ये दवाई अच्छी है, ठीक है, कि एक खा लूँगा, लेकिन मुझसे कोई कहे आधे घंटे चल लो, क्या आधे घंटे तो बहुत लंबा टाइम है, ये गोली ये आधे घंटे में 50 गोलियाँ खा लूँगा, लेकिन वो आधे घंटे में चलना ज़रा मुश्किल काम है ना। तो बिलीव एंड एन्जॉयमेंट, ठीक है। लोग खेलते हैं, उसमें कितनी तकलीफ होती है उनको अंदाज़ा नहीं होता, लेकिन वो उनका जो जो कहते हैं ना एक मीटर जो होता है वो दूसरी तरफ होता है, प्लेजर की तरफ होता है। डांस बहुत अच्छा लगता होगा देखने में, लेकिन जो करता है उसका जिस्म से पूछे क्या गुजरता होगा, वेरी पेनफुल, लेकिन उसको मज़ा आता है, खेलने में मज़ा आता है, लोग खेलते हैं। तो बात चीज़ें अपने जहन को ना उस तरफ कैसे फिक्स करें कि हम कहें कि हमें वॉक करने में मज़ा आता है, हमें रनिंग में मज़ा आता है, हमें खाना खाने में मज़ा आता है। अगर मैं किसी से पूछूं खाने में क्या मज़ा आता है, हु विल डिफाइन कि क्या मज़ा आता है, डिफाइन करें कोई, जस्ट आस्क एनीबॉडी, किसी से डिफाइन करें, टेस्ट क्या होता है, डिफाइन टेस्ट, अच्छा होता है बुरा होता है, बस दे डिफाइन टेस्ट, क्या फ्लेवर है, क्या अरोमा है, क्या। हमारे दादा जब खाना खाते थे वो बताते थे इसमें कितना नमक है, कितनी हल्दी है, कितना पुदीना है, कितना क्या है, पर हमें तो पता ही नहीं चलता इसमें है या नहीं है, निगल लेते हैं। तो वी आर एक्चुअली क्या कहते हैं, स्वेलिंग, स्वेलो करते हैं, वी डोंट ईट, और ईट करने में क्या होता है, वी हैव टू च्यू फॉर वेरी लॉन्ग पीरियड, 30-32 दफ़ा च्यू करना है कम से कम, और खाना खाने का ड्यूरेशन जो है हाफ एन आवर्स तक होना चाहिए। कितनी देर लगाते हैं खाना खाने में, मतलब है ठीक है ना। तो जब खाने नहीं खाते आप निगलते हैं तो यही होगा, पेट निकलेगा, खाना खाएंगे तो पेट नहीं निकलेगा, निकलेंगे तो पेट निकलेगा, वक्त नहीं है लोगों के पास ना। थैंक यू वेरी मच।
Thank you so much, Dr. Akhil Ahmed, for that presentation and a very interesting and interactive question and answer session. Next, we have from the School of Pharmacy, University College London, Professor Dr. Shozab Heather. Professor Shozab Heather did his master's from the University of Leeds and was awarded a PhD in biophysics in 2003 under the supervision of Professor Stephen Needle at the Institute of Cancer Research in London. For the thesis, he was able to solve the first crystal structure of guanine quadruplex with a drug. He did his postdoctoral fellowship with Professor Francis Ashcroft, FRS, at the University of Oxford. After this, he worked for 3 years at the Center for Cancer Research and Cell Biology, Queen's University of Belfast, and then moved to University College London in 2013 to set up his group in computational biophysics. He is also an editor for the journals eLife and Frontiers in Biomolecular Science. The title of Professor Shozab Heather's talk today is Artificial Intelligence in Drug Discovery. To learn more about this, let's put our hands together for Professor Dr. Shozab Heather as I invite him to the podium.
Thank you very much. Before I begin, to the organizers for inviting me, Dr. Kashif, Dr. Mukati, and the organizers. Can I have these things closed, lights closed? I have some movies. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. More. These ones also, please. Thank you. I know I'm the only person standing between you and lunch, so I'll be very quick. So I completely appreciate that fact. So, I don't know if you were paying attention to Dr. Chaudhary's talk. I mean, he said something very interesting. And he said that more people are publishing in life sciences that are not life scientists. So I am a physicist by training, and I have interest in drug discovery. So when you bring things down to drug discovery, everything is molecular. And at that molecular level, Everything is chemistry obeying laws of physics, nothing else. There's no such thing as biology, there's no such thing as life sciences. It's simple, simple laws of nature that takes place. Now, so what do I do and why am I interested in this? So one of the things that I do is I'd like to call myself not a physicist, nothing. I look at methods and how I can find any method that exists on the planet and can apply to a problem that I am interested in. And here I'm going to talk to you about machine learning and some methods that I look for from, not in biology, but from fluid dynamics, or from, you know, how you can study tsunamis, for example, or any method that, and how can you apply it to a problem that is related to drug discovery for myself. And the targets that I'm interested in are these simple enzymes called beta-lactamases, and I'll show you how they become so important to us. How do I move forward? Okay. So if you read the latest WHO guidelines, you will have more deaths from antibiotic resistance by 2050 than any other disease, more than cancer, more than anything else. This is something that we ignore. And if I ask you, how many of you take antibiotics without prescription, I can say more than 70% of this room will do that. And that is the cause of this thing, right? So it exists and it's growing and it's a big problem. Not just human consumption. This ever-growing population that exists in the world needs to be fed. And they need to be fed all these producers that come out of animal produce or plant produce. And in order to keep them bug-free, in order to keep them healthy, we feed antibiotics to them. So the consumption of antibiotics for agricultural plants and animals is much, much more. And it's only until very recently that some genes that were responsible for antibiotic resistance started appearing in these food that people began to take notice that, look, this can be transmissible, and so we should not be using a lot of these antibiotics. So what was the alarming signs? So there are certain antibiotics that you can just buy from the shop, and then there are certain antibiotics which you will never ever get your hands on. For example, some antibiotics that are given to you post-surgery or if you're in the hospital and that environment. Now, when you become resistant to those antibiotics, those are called last resort antibiotics, that is the problem, that you are not going to heal yourself if you are going to be resistant to those antibiotics. And my colleague at UCL, Neil Woodford, a couple of years ago, identified this amazing, amazing enzyme called New Delhi beta-lactamase, metallo-beta-lactamase, that is very, very prevalent in India and in Pakistan and the Indian subcontinent, the whole place. And initially, the way it started was, and how, and it's a very interesting story, and I worked with Neil on a very, very close basis. So there was this patient that decided to have a hip replacement. He was a Swedish man living in London. He decides to go to Delhi for medical tourism. He gets his hip replaced. He comes back to London, and he falls sick. And then they are treating him with antibiotics, and it turns out he's resistant to 20 antibiotics, which is completely unheard of in the West. And so the entire team came out here to India and to Pakistan to study, where is this? You know, what is this? This is something, you know, it just doesn't happen. Then they found this new enzyme, which they first found in Delhi, so they call it in the New Delhi metallo-beta-lactamase. And as a result, now this New Delhi beta-lactamase is everywhere. And you just saw in the past 2 years how coronavirus spread from Wuhan to the rest of the world. Exactly the same way this bacteria is found this enzyme is found every single place. But coming back to the issue is, somebody can ask yourself, why antibiotics? What makes these things so different, you know? So if you take any drug that you take on the market, you give it to a patient, you have clinical effect, or you might have cytotoxicity, and then the effect of the drug stops there, right? But if you give an antibiotic to the patient, it can have the similar effects of a drug if it works, like clinical effect or have some cytotoxicity. But if it does not, it then gets incorporated into the microbe, which gets excreted into the environment, and it can come back to you and it can propagate, propagating that gene which is resistant to that particular antibiotic. So having a complete dose of antibiotic is so important, so that you need to get rid of this bacteria by using that antibiotic. So there are several ways how these antibiotics work, lots and lots of ways. And this is a chart I don't expect you to read, I just want to show you that there are many ways. But the most common way of how these antibiotics are removed is by expression of a simple enzyme called a beta-lactamase, right? So it's a small enzyme, and I'll show you the structure. There are several thousands of these enzymes that are known to us. And of these, class A is the one that I'm going to look at. It's very, very common. And this is the structure. This is what it looks like. And of course, I mean, being a physicist, I'd like to see things, what I do, so I know, I solve crystal structures. And this is what the enzyme looks like. So here is the binding site right in the middle, and this is what the catalysis looks like. It's a simple enzyme, but the beauty of this enzyme, it's the one of the most fastest enzymes known to us. When I say fastest, ultra fast, it means that as you give the antibiotic, it chops it off. So the rate of catalysis approaches the rate of diffusion limit of your substrate. And this is the reaction it catalyzes. So one of the speakers earlier was talking about some antibiotics. So this antibiotic resembles how the cell wall, the linkages of the cell wall are formed in bacteria. The enzyme comes in, it chops off this beta-lactam ring, it renders it completely useless, it recycles itself, and then the antibiotic is useless. It's completely gone. So it just chops off the antibiotic. It's like a if you have seen a Pac-Man, it's just like a Pac-Man gobbling up, you know, things. So it just works ultra fast. So simple questions for drug discovery, right? How do these ultra fast enzymes communicate? How do these enzymes talk between different parts of these enzymes? And that's what I'm interested in. And how are these allosteric sites and active sites linked? So if you have to design a drug, you really need to understand what your enzyme is doing. And without understanding that, it just becomes, you know, an exercise in futility, because you just don't know the entire parameters. But usually in drug discovery, what happens is that there's a change in conformation, you can see pockets opening up, or for which you can design a drug. Not in this case, because it's so fast, you cannot trap the enzyme. So how do these things communicate? So we do standard molecular dynamics. It's a very standard technique. And then non-equilibrium dynamics, which is also a very standard technique. But then I look in the literature. Is there anything that I can get any hint from which will help me study how these enzymes communicate, you know, between one part to the other? So what is the inherent mechanism of communication, structural communication in these enzymes. And then I looked at a paper from 1975, and what they were looking at is simple, you know, this is a general simple phenomenon in physics that these people were studying, Gianni Cicotti and Giacuzzi, and what they were doing is that they were trying to look at a simple response of a particle under molecular dynamics. What happens when you perturb a particle? And this entire study was based on an old paper. Oops. Yeah. So this entire paper was based on this 1931 observation by Lars Onsager. Now Lars went on to win the Nobel Prize in 1968. But in 1931, he published a paper where he said a very simple thing. He says, in nature, you have harmonicity. So things are fluctuating, things are vibrating all the time, And that vibration is equilibrium. It comes back to that position of equilibrium. However, if you perturb a system, which means that if you displace its original equilibrium, it will fall back to its equilibrium state in exactly the same manner as a normal finite perturbation, right? Then in 1957, Ryogo Kubo came in and he added the time component to this. So which means that he said that if you can measure the perturbation and you can measure the relaxation time coming back to its original state, you would be able to define two properties, the perturbed property and your equilibrium state. And this is how tsunamis are measured. So you see the perturbed state, which is the earthquake, and how the tsunamis move, and then how they relax back to its original state, right? So we thought, can we apply this to protein systems, right? And we did exactly that. So here is our blue, is our normal state, the equilibrium state. And then these are short stretches of non-equilibrium perturbations, right, which we make. And then we measure between, at certain time intervals, regular time intervals, what are the differences between the perturbed state at time t is equal to 0, at t is equal to 1, at t is equal to 2, and measure the difference. Now, you can use any property you want to measure, which you can measure, right? So here we choose C alpha atoms, but you can choose anything you want to. It's up to you. Anything that you can measure, that you can define, you can do that. So this is the enzyme. We took two systems here, and what we did was, we said that here's the drug molecule. This is a crystal structure. It's widely available in one system. And in the other system, here is the drug molecule here at the end, the allosteric site 2, right? Now, what we said, we have to make a perturbation. What is going to be that perturbation? The perturbation is that we will remove this ligand completely out of its binding site. What will happen, it will give a shock to the whole system. There will be a vacuum. The entire protein, the binding site chains will come in so that it doesn't like a vacuum. Water will go in. It will try to compensate for that vacuum space. Then, when these new site chains come in, they will create a vacuum. Then the other side chains in the protein will come back and try to, you know, stabilize the protein. And as a result, you will see a wave. And that wave will travel on the inherent networks which are embedded in this protein, right? So we will start from two different positions, in one enzyme here and in the second enzyme here. We run our protocol and we run our simulations. So you see that these are the red parts are the most moving parts of this of your protein. The blue parts do not move. Then what you can do is you can see, measure what is moving. This is the equilibrium simulations. You can map it exactly. Of course, around the binding site, you will see a lot of red because that is where the most fluctuation is going to be. But then at the same time, what you can do is you can do non-equilibrium simulations to measure the differences between a system where I'm not taking the ligand out, and when I've given it a shock, which is the perturbed state, right? And I measure the whole thing. And what you can do is you can look at the differences here, and then simply look, map them exactly how they are moving. Now I'll show you a movie, because in a movie, you can see exactly how these networks light up like a bulb. Oops. Can you press the movie? There's one. No, the one. There should be a movie here. Is there a link on here? No? Oops, never mind. Okay, that's all right. Sorry, movies failed. Okay, so here what you can see, and I can explain it to you here, is that when you take the signal, so the signal starts from here, and you can see the signal going up here, going onto the omega loop, and then coming down here. In the second protein, it starts from here. You can follow the entire path of how the signals are moving as the time progresses, which means that you know that, you know, at time t is equal to 0, this is the first set of interactions that the protein will have. Then at time t is equal to 1, this is the next set of interactions that they have, so on and so forth. All good. how is it clinically relevant that I'm doing? You know, I'm doing all sorts of things, but is there any relevance that I can relate to clinical data? So what we did was we went into the literature, we pulled out every single mutation that exists for this. And if you look, I have plotted these yellow balls as mutations. Almost all mutations lie on the path where the signal lies. They might not be in the active site, but they are there on the path in which the signal is traveling, which means that if any mutations happens on any part of that path, that signal will be stopped, and the signal will not follow what you are doing, right? So it will not happen under normal circumstances. So this is fine, we did all of this. Then the big question for drug discovery is, can we separate these enzymes using artificial intelligence or using machine learning into a particular set that is hydrolyzing a particular antibiotic and not the others? So what we did was we started doing we used a convolutional variational autoencoder. We take the high dimensionality of MD simulation. So every single dot or data point is a structure. It tells us what structures are similar or dissimilar. We take all our systems, put them in a box, shake it, and we say, now separate it and show me all enzymes that are hydrolyzing a particular antibiotic and the other ones that are not hydrolyzing a particular antibiotic. So what we do is, this is what an autoencoder looks like. We put in all the data. This is the machine learning part of it. It learns from every single data point that it occurs, and then it reconstructs the whole thing. The data sets, it clusters it into different regions. Of course, we calculate the latent dimension loss over here. Of course, we can do that for seven dimensions, and then, of course, we see if the original is equivalent to the predicted, and then finally, we can plot this. Now, if you can see SME, I don't expect you to read anything, just look at the colors. So the blue, black, and pink are clustering together, whereas black and green, the TEM1 and KPC2 are clustering together. So what this is telling you is that the dynamics of carbapenemases, which is here in black and pink, SHV and KPC, is similar to SME and TEM, which is dissimilar. So how we are using this is that we've gone on a very large scale doing these multi-dimensional simulations with various different antibiotics. And the way it works is that if a patient comes to me and says to me, look, I am SHV, I will say, look, do not give them these antibiotics, because this is not how they are clustering together. So we are trying to make a prediction of how treatment regimens would come through for drug discovery using this, right? And all this has been published in eLife. This work was done wonderfully by my students, Yanis and Shen. I get funded by NIH and MolSoft, and I'm happy to take questions. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you very much. I'm not a scientist in any way, but just a very layman's question, because you started your presentation by talking about how important it is, well, the effects and impact of antibiotics. And that here in Pakistan, I think maybe in other countries also, we tend to just self-prescribe. You know, you've got a bad throat, so you'll take erythrosin or whatever else. And then often people don't take the full course. So you've explained how important it is to take the entire course. But can you expand a little bit more about a frequent use of antibiotics that are prescribed by our physicians? There's a tendency in Pakistan to prescribe antibiotics for even something mild. You have a mild throat or you have a mild upset stomach, and invariably our doctors will prescribe you antibiotics. Whereas if you go to the West, in London, very rarely will a doctor do that. So could you expand on that a little bit?
I think the nexus between the pharma companies and the doctors should be broken, because for every prescription they get a kickback. So that should go. And not just that. So that is one problem. The other problem is prescription-less. You know, when they go to the pharmacy, nobody asks for a prescription. So first, the doctors needs to be conscientious enough not to prescribe it, and then you should be conscientious enough not to take it, right? Because you know that if erythromycin works for you, for everything you're just going to go and take it, you know, because it will, and then you'll just take it 2 days till your whatever malady you have alleviates, and then you'll stop. And that's where the problem comes in. Because see, all these things are collective. It's a collective societal problem. It's not your problem. Because if the resistant bacteria comes out from you, it's going into the environment. It's going to affect me. It's just like wearing a mask, you know. You can infect more vulnerable people. And that's how the whole thing is. There are huge programs by WHO on just saying that, look, just educating on the bad use of antibiotics. And it's happening in the third world a lot, where regulation is very poor. Yeah, there's no regulation. That's it. Yeah. No. Because the thing in West is that your license will be taken away. They'll take your license, and your livelihood will go. Here, there's no such thing as that, and that's the problem. Pharmacy is not regulated in the third world at all, which is a very, very important point.
Thank you so much, sir, for the nice talk, actually.
Yeah.
And actually, I have two questions. Actually, being a competitive chemist, actually, I was also curious about the things that, what methods did you use for determining, assessing the allosteric communication? Of course, I have been working with you, of course. So what actually methods that did you have the principal component analysis?
Nothing. It's a very simple thing. I am just taking two systems.
Okay.
One system is the equilibrium system. Mm. The other one is the perturbed system. And I'm measuring the difference between the equilibrated state and the perturbed state. That's it.
Okay, and then other thing that I wanted to like know. So here in the Zavest, actually, alhamdulillah, we have also been working on the beta-lactamases, and we are targeting the beta-lactamases of especially Mycobacterium. So actually, I was interesting to directly target the beta-lactamases instead of penicillin-binding proteins, because beta-lactamases actually dissociate the drugs, beta-lactams, that are targeting actually the penicillin-binding proteins. So I was somehow confused. Can you please guide me that it is possible that we can directly inhibit and we can directly target this allosteric communication and the binding communication of the directly beta-lactamases of the Mycobacterium?
That is exactly what we are doing. That's how we design allosteric inhibitors. So what do these antibiotics do? So mm-hmm. there is a DD peptidoglycan linkage that penicillin binding proteins do. Mm-hmm. And these drugs bind to the penicillin binding protein to stop that transpeptidase reaction. When the beta-lactam comes, it chops off the antibiotic, mm-hmm. and those linkages are not formed. So you can directly target these rather than targeting the
penicillin
binding
proteins.
Exactly.
And the last question, actually, and the other thing that, because I will also be assessing my systems for, of course. So I haven't run unequilibrated systems. I have just run a calibrated system. So what specific dynamical perspective you suggest? Should I go for the residual dynamics analysis directly?
You can do whatever you want to measure. It's
up
to you.
Are the methods that we earlier used in our interdynamics subunit paper that for the machine learning?
See, everything is system specific, right? If you are a system, so you have to see your system, what is it doing,
okay.
right? You have to understand your system, and that's why we ran so much, is because we want to understand our system. Once you understand the system, you can say, fine, I'm doing a C alpha deviation, or I'm looking a center of mass deviation.
Alpha deviation, actually,
anything
yes.
that you want. Anything that you want.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you so much, sir, for this nice presentation.
In an enzyme, there are different binding sites, like major binding sites, allosteric binding site, and orthostatic binding sites. And to have a perturbed state, you have targeted on the allosteric binding sites, site 1 and site 2. So why is it so important to have targets on allosteric binding sites? Why not on orthostatic binding sites?
See, we know that if we inhibit orthosteric binding site, that is the site where catalysis takes place, right? But what we want to know is that, what is allostery? Allostery is that your drug molecule will bind to somewhere really far away from your binding site, and then some signals will come and it will inhibit this, right? That's allostery. So we want to know, how is that signal coming through in such fast enzymes? So if we target just the, we've inhibited the enzyme, so what's the point? We want to see how the signal is traveling from across. From such a long, when ligand binds to some really far off site, how is it coming down to that, to the place where catalysis is stopped? And all these mutations, that clinical mutations occur, they're not occurring all in the binding site. They are occurring really far off from the binding site. And then when these mutations comes and the doctors say, oh, it's not in the binding site, we don't know what is happening. So now we know that it is on the path of that signal that it blocks that signal from moving forward. And there are over so many mutations which you can look at.
Well, this is very nice to be in your talk, because Adrian Mulholland, which is mentioned here, is my regular collaborator in UK. So my first question is, like, you talked about the perturbed state, and why you, means I should not say ignoring, but why you are not considering the apoenzyme itself. That will be a good set for comparison.
How are you going to do? So you have to choose a perturbation. You can choose any perturbation. Our perturbation was the ligand.
Okay. So did you check it in, like, in apoenzyme?
Yeah. So the I'm comparing it with the apoenzyme.
Okay. That's
I have to do a delta. I have to do one versus the other. So one is the apo. One is the perturbed state with the ligand. So I take the ligand out. I see what are the changes here. And then I measure it with the reference, which is the apo state.
And what interesting was deep learning. So what deep learning was affecting the main general reason of having antibiotic resistance of that beta lactam protrusion, and you know why the mutation exactly?
No. So what we do with deep learning, okay. Deep learning, what we wanted to do is every single point, data point that we have in our simulation is a confirmation. Now, we have lots of data points from various enzymes. Each enzyme is behaving differently, right? So how do we learn from such large data points? So we put them in a box and we shake it, right?
Yeah, you put them in a box and shake it and you got
the results. And then we cluster it.
But is this actually affecting the reasons of antibiotic resistance, which is, of course, the mutation and the perturbation of beta-lactam and, you know, the main binding? Is there any connection with them?
No. What this is telling us is that how enzyme dynamics works, which means that two enzymes are behaving exactly in the same manner, will have same amount of catalysis, will have the same reaction mechanisms versus the other two. So if you're likely to give an antibiotic like to that, it will be very different from this.
That's great. It's actually my area. That's why I was very interested in.
Yeah.
And do you think that you just oversee the Metropolis and Ariel Warshall and Michael Levitt for their Nobel Prize in dynamics, because actually they have put a lot of efforts on integrating the time equation, when especially in connection with proteins?
Well,
that was my last comment.
No. But the thing is that we work with a lot with Chicotti as well. So the person who developed this method at was. So there's another paper which I don't talk about. Me and Adrian have both have published with him. So again, it's very case specific. You cannot have a blanket. You have to know your target. And that's what we are doing.
Assalamu alaikum, sir. I have a question that you just mentioned.
Yes.
Okay. That you just mentioned about something like signaling about of proteins. So we are also working on this sort of project in our FIP. So I wanted to ask about that when we drug repurpose, so here, jo aapne jaise bataya ki signalings ki wajah se bahut sari mutations aayi. So after repurposing of that drug, to kisi bhi disease ke liye jab hum use it, karenge to kya wahan par bhi uski mutations agar ho sakte hain?
These mutations, ye jo mutations hain, ye clinical mutations hain, ye patients mein hoti hain. कई बार क्या होता है कि हम उन म्यूटेशंस का एक्सप्लेनेशन नहीं दे पाते हैं क्योंकि वो बाइंडिंग साइट से बहुत दूर होती हैं, ठीक है ना, तो हम उनको एक्सप्लेन ही नहीं कर पाते कि क्या हो रहा है। लेकिन जब हम इस तरह की स्टडी करते हैं और जब म्यूटेशंस उस सिग्नलिंग पाथवे पे आती है तो हम ये कह सकते हैं कि ये म्यूटेशन सिग्नलिंग के बाद नहीं आ रही हैं, ये दिस इज अ डेटा फ्रॉम द हॉस्पिटल फ्रॉम द पेशेंट्स, अलग अलग पेशेंट्स का डेटा है, ये म्यूटेशंस क्लिनिकली रेलेवेंट म्यूटेशंस हैं। और जब हम इनको क्या नाम है अपनी नॉन इक्विलिब्रियम सिमुलेशंस में पाथवेज पर प्लॉट करते हैं तो देखते हैं कि ये वही रूट ले रही है जहाँ पे सिग्नल जा रहा है, और ये म्यूटेशन जब अराइज करेंगे तो ये सिग्नल को ब्लॉक कर देंगे।
थैंक यू।
ओके, थैंक यू।
Thank you so much for that interesting presentation. I would now like to invite Madam President Ms. Shehnaz Wazir Ali onto the stage for the shield distribution to our guest speakers. I would also request Dean Faculty Life Sciences, Dr. Kashif Ali, to make your way to the stage and join Madam President. Professor Dr. Akil Ahmed, please make your way to the stage. Professor Shozib Heather, please make your way to the stage. Thank you so much. Thank you so much to our guest speakers for today, Madam President and Dr. Kashif. You may head you back. Yes, thank you so much. And with this, the second part of the conference for today comes to a short interval. Students, I request you to please make your way towards room number 13 in an orderly fashion. I request all of the faculty and esteemed guests to head towards room number 6 for lunch and prayer break. We will reconvene afterwards for the panel discussions. Thank you so much.